Hey everyone, it's Frankie, and we're going to do something a little different today. We're going to start off with a conversation I had with Brothershipper, Jason D'Agostino, and he's going to talk about the podcast that he has. So go support him and his podcast just as much as you do my podcast, Broken Kayfabe, and Breaking Kayfabe with Baldrin and Barry. I am pleased to be joined here by Brothershipper, Jason D'Agostino. Jason, thank you for coming and telling us about your great podcast.
Thanks for having me on, Frankie. I'm a Brothershipper with some podcasts. Travis Raines has plugged my main show a few times in the Brothership, and that would be the Not Another Sports Podcast. So that's a bi-weekly show I do with my best friend David. It's about an hour of us just doing the same thing we did in his parents' basement as teenagers, talking sports and making each other laugh. And then I also have a monthly Philadelphia Phillies podcast because I am a huge Phillies fan. That is called the Philly Baseball Together podcast. And that is actually under the umbrella of a bigger podcast network. And last year that was in the top 200 of baseball podcasts in North America.
Nice.
Yeah, I was surprised, honestly. And then my final one, I do the Punk podcast with a gentleman named Brad, who is with Baseball Together. Now, he lives out in Arizona, and over the last 2 years, we've gotten to know each other through doing podcasts and talking baseball, and we found we both love the pop-punk genre of music. So that's just a half hour every week. Right now, we're on a break, but we do that 15 episodes a season, and it's really just us telling stories about our youth tied to the songs and albums of that type of music.
Very cool. So you stay kind of busy with the podcasting.
You know, my wife said for years I needed a hobby, and now this hobby is like taking everything over.
So where can people find your podcast?
So the Not Another Sports Podcast, you can find, well, all three of them, actually, you can find on anchor.fm, Spotify, iTunes, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, pretty much wherever you can find them. They're there. And all three of them are also available on YouTube. God forbid anyone actually wants to watch me talk about stuff, you go and have at it.
Well, cool, man. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you, Frankie.
Willie, Willie, mercy, baby. This is Shaska Willie. You're listening to Broken Kayfabe with Frankie Seabreeze and Ariel Bologna and Cheese Sandwich. They're like Coca-Cola. They're all over, baby, on whatever network that you find it on, baby.
This is Navy SEAL Body Guy, and you are listening to Broken Kayfabe with Frankie Seacrest, Ariel Agbalog, and the Brothership. Now that half-wit Shaska Willie better not step on this, or I will step on him, Jack.
Welcome to Broken Kayfabe, the unofficial after show of Breaking Kayfabe with Baldrin and Barry, the most altruistic podcast on the planet, the podcast, the only podcast that's dedicated to the listeners of another podcast. What's up, Ariel?
What's up with you? I'm just chilling right now. I worked last night. I'm just relaxing, and I'm watching food vlogs on YouTube, just waiting until I fall asleep.
Well, tell me, what do you know about Madeira Beach?
Absolutely nothing, except for that the video I'm watching right now, the host is at that area, and there's a restaurant there that looks interesting called Big Ray's Fish Camp. And I heard that Madeira Beach is the grouper capital of the world, I think. That's what he said. And he ordered a lobster corn dog for $24. And it looks massive. It looks like an entire lobster tail that's been battered and deep fried. it looks crazy. And there's another sandwich he got, like a blackened grouper sandwich that looks absolutely amazing.
So, okay, so what's the name of this show?
It's a Strictly Dumpling.
Strictly Dumpling, okay. And, yeah. And who is this person who is from Madeira Beach?
No, he's the host is in the Tampa area, so he hit up one of the restaurants over here, over there, and it happened to be Big Ray's Fish Camp, and he mentioned that, you know, he was in the Tampa Bay area, and I thought of you, and, you know, yeah, so I figured, you know, if you knew this restaurant or have been there.
Well, it's actually in Tampa.
Oh, it's in Tampa. So what the hell was he talking about, Madeira Beach? Okay, never mind. It's in Tampa. So,
well I'm going to watch it. I've got the video. Lobster corn dog and the number one best garlic blue crab. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
Okay, I'm going to watch that, and I'll let you know. So as you saw on the map that I sent you, I am two blocks. Yeah, from Madeira Beach.
Okay, I think I heard him say that. Right when he was walking up to the restaurant. So he could have just said, you know, mentioned that as being the grouper capital of the world, and he's going to go get a grouper sandwich in this particular restaurant. So that's probably why I thought that restaurant was in that area.
Okay, I'm going to watch it anyway. I'm going to get my opinion of what he may talk about other places in Madeira Beach. So I'm anxious to hear it. We do not go out to eat a lot. You know, Barry Rose, when he comes down to this area, he'll say, "Hey, have you had this place?" And I'll say, "No." He'll say, "What?"
Yeah.
You've lived here 3 years and you haven't? No, we don't go out to eat a whole lot. We do the DoorDash occasionally, maybe once every couple of weeks, but we don't go out to eat a lot. You know, one place that we did go and we do like to go is the Salt Rock Grill. And it's a little pricey. I don't know how my wife would describe it, because she would probably describe it a lot better than me. It's on the water. If you go on Sundays, there's some deal where you get like $5 drinks and then like $15 a plate, as opposed to the usual, you know, $20, $30, $40 a plate.
Ooh, that's not bad. That's not, that's like a happy hour thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. On Sundays.
Oh, on Sundays. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's not bad.
That's cool. So look, some of the prices here on the seafood, $39. Oh, there's $70 South African fire roasted lobster tails, roasted plank salmon, $20, stuffed sea bass, $36, lobster, and shrimp saute, $37. That's a place that we've been to a couple of times, and we have a gift certificate to go there. So, so maybe tomorrow, I don't know.
Yeah, sounds good. Go for it.
Yeah, cool. So, some things you don't know. Last night I recorded with Matt Crowder again, your Bay Area brother.
Brother, yeah.
And then also Rick Nathan.
Cool. Did you get to interview Matt's testicles also?
How could we not? They were right there in our face.
They should have their own show.
That's true. Maybe we'll have nothing but an interview with Matt's testicles.
Yeah, and the ox penis that I ate. Matt's testicles and Ariel's ox penis.
Oh, wow.
Okay, that's the end of the show, guys. Thank you very much. All right.
Well, in all seriousness, I do have to go pick up my daughter.
Yeah.
Tomorrow should be better. We she's with her dad at the water park, and Jana had got tickets to see a Rowdies, which is amateur soccer or professional soccer here in the area, and she asked Alex, you know, who he would want to take, and he said his dad, and I, you know, of course, I suggested his dad because it's him and his dad that play the sports together. So they're going to the game tonight, and Andy's going to come and stay with us. So we have to go pick her up from the water park where they're all at right now.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's cool.
So that's what we're going to do. And so tomorrow, maybe I'll have more time. Tomorrow, we'll jump right into the news of the WWE and what's going on.
All right. Sounds good.
Before we go, please watch The Boys.
Okay. Yeah, if I have time. I that's on my list. I have a bucket list long of, like, I haven't seen Ozark yet. And
Dude, I'm telling you, this third season of The Boys. Oh, my gosh.
Third season. Okay, yeah. They just started, right?
Yeah.
Do they put out the entire season, or is it like week by week?
Week by week.
Week by week. Okay, cool.
Yep. So you got the whole season of season two you can watch.
Yeah, I got to catch up.
But I'm going to kind of spoil just a smidgen of it when we talk about the news, because there was something that happened that sort of compares to something else that happened this week.
Okay.
Cool. Well, thank you. So we knocked out a little bit of an intro. We only got, you know, a little bit more.
Yeah.
So we're talking about Jeff Hardy, Vince McMahon, and that whole thing.
Yeah. Yeah. What a week. So right? Far. That's crazy. Yeah. I got to look more into it for the, especially the Vince McMahon one, because like so many things happening. Stephanie came back as a interim CEO. I think what's his face? Other than Vince and John Laurinaitis, what's his name? Kevin Dunn, right? Isn't he being investigated for insider trading?
That's correct. Yep.
Yeah. So there's stuff I'm going to have to read up on when I'm at work tonight.
So Ariel, did you listen to last week's podcast?
Yes, I did. Remind me again what it was about.
I have no idea. Not a clue.
But, which podcast? Our podcast or Breaking Kayfabe?
Yeah. Our podcast, yeah.
Yeah. I did. I just forgot.
So did you hear the soundbite of Jason D'Agostino talking about his podcast?
Yes, I did.
Okay. We didn't talk about it, so I wanted to talk about it now. Jason, of course, is in the Brothership. Mm-hmm. And he had said, hey, tell me a little bit about your podcast and I'll promote it on my podcast. And I said, all right, well, I'll do the same and then we'll have you on and we'll talk. So we recorded that. It took me a little bit to get it edited and whatnot. But he's got three podcasts. And so Brothershippers, go support your fellow brother, Jason D'Agostino, and his podcast. He talks about sports in general, I think, Phillies. And then he has another one of like new wave punk pop or punk pop. And I was only able to listen to the first episode of the punk pop one, because it's the only one that showed up on my, my feed on my app. I use the Downcast app on the iPhone. And it was only able to pull up the very first one. But, here's how I'm going to put it over. You know, he's got three different things. You can hear him talk about sports. You can hear him talk about Phillies. And then you can hear him talk about Pac Pump. But one of my big pet peeves or requirements for listening to a podcast is it has to have good audio. And his audio is superb. So please go listen to the Brothership. Give him a few more downloads. And Ariel, speaking of downloads, we're up a little bit, bud.
What? Really? By like three or what? Well, I mean, well, I'm excited.
Almost, what is almost 100 a week.
No way.
Yeah.
Like we doubled?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Right?
No thanks to me. I barely talk on this podcast.
That's my fault. I'm a big
No, mouth. It's fine. No, it's great. It's because, you know, you have a lot more to say. I'm just here trying not to be, you know, crass or or foul mouth or whatever, because I'm pretty different in real life.
That's true.
In terms of personality and stuff like that. So,
yeah. Well, I would love it if you talked more. That means I would talk less. And I am one of those people who don't enjoy hearing myself talk. So, feel free. Feel free to take the reins and talk us through another fantabulous episode.
I'll let you know when I have something to talk about or something like that, or a question is asked from the Brothershippers or anything that you ask me. I'll probably have something to say about, you know.
Well, good. I do have something to ask you.
Sure.
How was your Father's Day?
Quiet. My dad went to work. I slept because I worked that night. So I just ordered, I cleaned the house a little bit. I ordered Wingstop for, you know, for my lunch and his dinner. And I went to sleep. And then, you know, he comes home when I'm asleep. So he's in bed by the time I wake up. And yeah, because he went back to work again. So, yeah, it was just a typical day. We didn't celebrate. My mom's in North Carolina right now. So it was just us two and the dog here. But our schedules don't really allow us to see each other too much. So, yeah, it was a very quiet Father's Day for me.
Okay, well, let's get to the important things then.
Your Father's Day?
No, man, come on. The food, bro. So tell me, what kind of sauce do you get on your wings?
I like to mix it up a bit, but I go with, for instance, Wingstop. I usually go for the either Korean or Hawaiian, and also with the garlic parmesan or lemon pepper.
Okay, hold on. Korean barbecue, I'm assuming you mean?
I guess so. It's labeled as Korean. I don't know what the freak that...
Okay.
I don't know what that
so
means.
So what does the Hawaiian sauce taste like?
Kind of like a sweet teriyaki. I'm sure there's like a bit of pineapple juice in there, but oh, yeah, man. Pretty much. Also, I get... If I'm in the mood, I get naked wings because I kind of make my own sauce too.
You do? Well, tell us about your own sauce, bud.
It's kind of along the lines of a teriyaki sauce, and then I just, what's it called? It's like a garlic teriyaki sauce, and then, okay, so it's kind of a dish in Hawaii. It's called furikake chicken, and it's just fried chicken, and covered in a sweet garlic teriyaki sauce, and then covered with furikake, which is the toasted seaweed and sesame seed rice seasoning. And that's what I, you know, that's what I eat it with. And then rice and stuff like that. So
damn, son.
Yeah. So, I mean, yesterday I got they have a new flavor, lemon, garlic wings. That was really good. And then I got my typical like Hawaiian, Korean and mild, hot sauce or, there's no mild hot sauce, but mild sauce and honey barbecue.
Mm-hmm.
My dad can't really have any spicy foods, so I got mild for him. Usually, if I'm in the mood, I'll get like Cajun, or if I'm feeling stupid, Atomic. And last time I got Atomic was, it wasn't that good on my stomach. I was the one that ate it all. I was like, ugh. Man, that was a bad move for me. I had to like eat it in multiple sittings.
so why can't your pops have spicy food?
He gets like gastrointestinal issues or something like that. Okay. Or he's had ulcers before. He's had heartburn issues. I have heartburn too. I get like acid reflux and stuff like that, you know. So he tries to avoid that because it'll make him physically ill. And I love spicy foods, but I got to be careful with the amount of spice I have for myself, because I do get prone to, you know, stuff like that too. Like I said, acid reflux and heartburn.
Okay.
Yeah. How about you?
I'm good.
I mean, you did talk about the that one time where you got, was it that 10 level 10?
yeah, that was my Thai food. But yeah. On the wings, I like a spicy barbecue.
Mm-hmm.
That's my number one favorite. I do like the spiciness. I do like the spicy foods. For my Father's Day, we We ended up having Andy. The kids are at their other dad's this weekend. They go back. We you know, trade the kids off on Friday and not trade them, but they go back to the other house every Friday. And so on Saturday, Jana had won these tickets to a Tampa Bay Rowdies game, which is, you know, Major League Soccer. Mm-hmm. And so she gave them to Alex as a gift and said, hey, you can take whoever you want. And with some coaxing, because he was obviously getting it from his mom. And the obvious answer is take his mom, right? Mm-hmm. But really, he probably wanted to take his dad. So we have to talk, hey, look, it's okay, bud, if you'd rather take your dad, because, you know, his dad pushes him to do all these sports and has signs him up for all this extra sports stuff and blah, 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 right? So they went to a Rowdies game, and Andy was going to be there along with her stepmom. And she said, so we had told her, hey, look, you know, if they're not doing anything and you want to come over, we'll come and get you. And so she said, well, let me see what, you know, her stepmom's got planned. And her stepmom's plan was they were going to go to her stepmom's house, her stepmom's brother's house, and watch the Tampa Bay Lightning hockey game, which would have been absolutely miserable for Andy. So she stuck up for herself, says, no, I'm going to go to mom's. And so we ended up having Andy, you know, from half a day on Saturday all the way till Sunday morning. And whenever we have the kids on, like whenever it's not their time, I always like to make it about the kids. I mean, I do anyway, right? I know that a lot of parents aren't like I am, but I'm a new parent. I've only been a parent for 3 years. This is my third Father's Day. Mm-hmm. So like I picked up Andy when they were coming over last time, and it was Friday at noon. And Alex was with his friends or something. And so I picked her up. And as soon as she got in the car, I said, well, what do you want to do? You know, it's your day. We don't have to, you know, because when you got your sibling, you have to take into consideration what your sibling wants to do. You know, it can't be all about one kid. So when you got one kid, it can be their special time, right? So that's kind of what we did on Saturday. I said, hey, what do you want to do? And so she really didn't have any ideas except for she wanted to go to a game room, and there's this game that she's playing where she collects these cards, and she's wanted to go and check and see if the rare card was in there. And so then we went to this interactive art thing that was really cool down at the St. Pete Fairgrounds, and it was really, really neat. All these artists like did these different rooms, and it was a theme, like it was the Mermaid Hotel. Mm-hmm. And all these rooms were really different and really cool and had all this interactive stuff. One of them, you had to put a code in and then something would happen. And I won't ruin it for anybody, but it was really cool that we figured out that code, even though we only had two of the numbers, right? So you had to have three numbers. And so we only had two. So then we just trial by error and figured it out.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. And then what I'm getting to is when it came time to eat, I wanted for my Father's Day meal, which was Saturday. We celebrated, you know, in part Saturday, but because Andy was going to be here, I wanted Indian food and the chicken tikka masala. Mm-hmm. And she does not like Indian food. So her and Jenna went and got Andy Panda Express. And then they were sneaky snooks and got me some cookies from Crumble, which were amazing.
Yeah.
And so I had the chicken tikka masala, and I eat it for two meals. And so it was absolutely delicious. I get the medium. Jana gets the mild. She doesn't like the spicy food so much. But it was absolutely delicious. And I spread that junk out over two meals. And it was, you know, it's just as good at the second meal as it is the first one.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's my eating over the weekend.
Nice.
Yeah. Hey, so While we're here and doing nothing and kind of got a little bit of a break, how about we go to the conversation I just had on Friday with Rick and Nathan and Matt Crowder. Now, these guys have been trying to sync up their schedules for a while, and I sort of bulldogged the conversations like I normally do. But this time, you know, Rick Nathan, he works in production and the movies in Hollywood and TV shows. And, my daughter is into acting. So last time that I spoke with him, I was going to let her ask a couple questions, but I think she fell asleep. And so she stayed up this time. She got a couple questions to ask him. And so I was debating on whether I wanted to include that part, but I am definitely going to include that part because Rick was more than gracious with his time of talking to my daughter about this and giving her some advice. And he was really happy and went into detail about it. You know, like, I don't know. He really went above and beyond. And my daughter, the whole time we were videoing, and the whole time we were doing this video, she was just smiling ear to ear. She just loved it so much. And she also asked Matt Crowder a question about Bruce Springsteen. So she asked, when we were talking about Rick, she says, well, I can't ask one guy a question and not the other one. She says, so what's Matt into? I'm like, well, you can ask him about Bruce Springsteen. And she's like, well, who's Bruce Springsteen? So I had to explain all that to her. And then she's like, oh, okay. She's like, oh, okay. And so she came up with asking his favorite place to see him, if he could only see him at one place. I said, that's a good question.
That's a really good question, actually. Yeah.
And so she asked those questions. But, before we go to this, I just want to thank Matt and Rick for their time. And Rick's going to come back on because he and Matt didn't get to have the conversation about wrestling and whatnot that they really wanted to have.
They were just talking about Matt's testicles the whole time, right?
Well, I didn't get to ask what is up with Matt's testicles. I really wanted to know because, you know, sometimes you see all these jokes in the group. And you don't get it, right? I need to know how did it get to be that Matt has ginormous testicles?
Well, have you seen them?
No, have you?
Yeah. No. No, man. What? Come on, man. No. Not so free, at least.
So let's go ahead and let's go to the conversation that I had with Rick Nathan, Matt Crowder, and my daughter, Andy Bell.
Hey, what happened to your beard, man? What happened to
it had to come off because, God damn it, I was literally eating it. So it was to a point where I'm just like, I'm having a burrito or a taco, and literally I'm eating what's fucking going in, and I'm just like, this will all go off at some point. I jokingly call it my laziness because literally, I mean, throughout the pandemic and just through stretches, I mean, I'm on a 2-week break from work right now because just needed it and be done with not being a responsible adult outside of, you know, my child, and my wife. And I'm just like, I'm taking a little break.
I mean, Shaska Willie did scare me a little bit.
Oh, God damn. I love doing that. No, the last one I did and the one I put up on the Facebook group, That was the creme de la creme. And I'm trying to think what the hell I did. And I'm like, you know what? I'm feeling frisky right now. I'm going to send this to Frankie because it was like a couple days before FanFest. I'm like, show this to everybody. And he's like, yeah, don't worry about it. And it's just, oh, it turned out really well. That one to me, if I can top that, I have made it in life. Let's just put it that way.
There we go. How did that pop out there? Okay. That doesn't sound right. See here. Bear with me, guys. I know Frankie's daughter is here, the actress. Hello, hello.
Hi.
You're talking to the right person because Rick can do anything, right, Rick?
Oh, anything. I'll build you a house.
You can get her to Spielberg. I know you got a good vibe with him. It's all good.
Yeah, me and Spielberg, we're like this. And ever widening. Is that like one of these all Jews know each other kind of thing?
I just picked the biggest name and goddamn
I never listen.
That makes me laugh. Oh my God.
I never see him at any of the secret meetings. So, well, you know.
if you're the one who's going to be in the bunker, you're the lucky one. Let's just put it that way.
Oh man. This is already a good time.
What a better way to spend a Friday night is my question. Don't go out to the bars. Don't go out to dinner. You just BS with people that you've met virtually for some of them for the first time and others.
Yeah, exactly. There
before. We go. It's just, it's great.
This is
it's
fun.
Great
fun. This is fine by me. I mean, I'm not like a huge drinker or anything. I mean, the reason I couldn't record before now is it was my wife's birthday last weekend. And then it was also my mom was in town, and my mom, as she's gotten older, I started drinking a lot more, and I don't even drink that much, but I drink more alcohol that weekend than I have in like the 3 years beforehand. And that was like, my dad was out about a month before that, and it was like the Bloody Mary tour of Southern California. And don't get me wrong, I love a good Bloody Mary. I'm something about tomato juice, that just spicy tomato juice that I'm totally down for. But good God, my liver is like, please, please, buddy, just give it a break for a little bit, you know.
Sounds like my cousin-in-law who's in Southern California. She's in Arcadia, and any family function, oh, here's a glass of wine. Oh, you don't have enough. Have another one. And I'm just like, gotta slow down. I love you to death, but
yeah,
she goes. She works hard. She plays hard. She works for CBS down in Los Angeles. She's she's a great lady. She is the life of the party. Let's just put it that way. She always has a fun time whenever the family gets together.
Nice. Frankie's turning this into a found footage film, found footage horror movie.
All right. What do you mean? This is THX1138. Come on, you know.
Oh God.
We're getting the art films here.
So, Rick, when was your wife's birthday?
It was Sunday, June 12th.
Okay. My wife's is June the 8th, and my father-in-law is June the 10th.
Geminis, they're amazing, aren't they?
Man, my wife is absolutely wonderful. But my daughter, Andy, there, she's got a couple of questions for each of you. Andy, you want to start there with Rick?
Yeah.
She disappeared.
I did disappear. Okay.
I don't blame her.
Abracadabra, Holmes.
Were you able to get a job in TV right after college? And if not, how did you eventually get one?
No, I didn't. Well, here's the thing. I was on a much different path. Frankie and I talked about this. So I came out here. I wanted to act. And I was doing some stuff. I was doing some extra work, and I was doing some little things here and there, like some trying to get some theater going. I was doing some stand-up comedy. And I wasn't looking for a job behind camera and TV. I was just looking to try and establish myself as an actor. And then kind of circumstances got me into – well, realistically, the woman who's my wife now is the one who got me into reality TV. She was working in reality TV. She was working on Cruise, and had worked really hard to get into that frame. And in 2003, she was working on Last Comic Standing Season 2, which was Jay Moore hosted. I don't know if you know the comedian Jay Moore, more from my generation really, but she was they needed a chaperone, and I needed money because I was working at I was kind of subletting my income with working at little jobs here and there, and I was at the time I was working at Blockbuster to kind of but when I was talking to Frankie, when I first came out here, I was kind of doing Gap and Circuit City, but then I kind of just transition to Blockbuster. It was a great Blockbuster. There were a lot of like stars that came into that store and stuff. But and so I went to do the job of the chaperone. They really liked me as the chaperone, and then they offered me a job as a post-production assistant. And from there, my career just kind of went here and there. And then as technology got better, because, you know, I mean, you're lucky you're a kid. You had, like, technology is kind of amazing for you right now. We're living in a pretty amazing technological age. And, I mean, it's only going to get more incredible, you know, as the three of us guys on here are just aging and are using walkers and whatever. But at the time, you know, I'm not going to say the internet was new. I mean, I remember when I was going onto bulletin boards in like 1994 with my friends, you know, so it wasn't exactly new, but it wasn't like it is now. And then all of a sudden there started to be sites on the internet in the 2000s, which were specifically for crew and people looking for people who wanted to work in the industry and places you could post your resume if you wanted to get found by people who were looking for people in the industry. And especially as reality was really starting to explode beyond your the shows that were on network TV and more into cable, people needed to crew up. That's kind of just how things went for me. But I really credit my wife, Valerie, with, she got me my start in the industry. In fact, with the every job I've kind of had from there has been a result of her, whether indirectly from that first gig or another gig she kind of got me onto, or people I knew from a gig she got me onto that moved me on to something else. I owe her a lot. That's not the reason I married her, because I owe her, but that's kind of, I mean, it doesn't hurt. I owe her a lot.
So how long was it from the time that you graduated college until you actually got a job in the film industry or movies or whatever?
Well, you know, probably about steady work. You know, I mean, I don't count like extra work or, you know, working on, like, at the time, low and independent films that were being filmed without a like, you could make a movie and then try and sell it to kind of go out into theaters. And that still happens occasionally. But not including those 2 years, couple of years, 3 years, two years. I moved out here in 1999. My first job was at IFC Films, working in marketing and distribution. Val got me into that gig too. Actually, she was working there, and they needed somebody else, and I needed money at the time. And that was really cool because that job, I worked for Bob Burney. And he's the guy who, he's like one of those guys who's a big guy without being a huge name in the, you know, kind of the layman areas. Like, you don't see him on, you don't see him out there like you would see, say, a Steven Spielberg or whatever. But he's the guy who basically got Memento done. You guys remember Memento?
Yeah.
And I was working on Memento. That was an interesting time. I was like a 24-year-old kid, and like million-dollar checks were coming, and I was responsible for like banking those. And I'm like holding $1 million in my hand, like, oh my lord! Like, you know, if I were a person with no scruples, you know. But he did that. He discovered the director Alfonso Cuarón, brought him over from Mexico. I worked a little bit on Donnie Darko, on like the distribution for Donnie Darko, because he was doing a favor for a friend of his at the time. And that was steady work. But they moved the offices to New York City, and I had promised myself I was not going to do New York City while I was that young. I mean, most of my friends from college, a lot of them went to New York City, and I've always viewed New York City as it's really great. If you do it one of two ways, if you're really wealthy, New York is an amazing town. If you're dead broke, New York is an amazing town for many different other reasons. But if you're kind of in the middle, which is where I was, it kind of sucks. I'd been to New York a ton of times. I mean, I grew up in the Northeast, so I mean, I knew New York. I had friends in New York. I could always go there, but I didn't care that much about being in that area of the industry to follow the office over there. And so for a while, they were kind of running the office from two different locations and moving stuff from LA to New York. And then 9/11 hit, and my boss, Bob, they were like at the Toronto Film Festival and they couldn't even get back into America for weeks. Which after that hit, which was kind of rough because I couldn't get paid for weeks. So that was, you know, and I mean, you know, it's far from the worst thing that happened from that and, you know, what have you, but it was a interesting time, but that was like kind of the, that was the first job. So about 2 years, 2 years. And then I was like finding myself without a gig. Went to Blockbuster, you know, trying to figure out what to do. Writer scripts, you know, 9/11 kind of put a damper on stuff. There were writer strikes going on in Hollywood. And I just knew I didn't want to go back to Rhode Island because there was nothing for me there. I mean, there's one major theater there. And I just thought to myself, like, am I going to fight every other actor in the state, you know, to try and do that one major theater? And then the rest of the time, you know, be working in, you know, there's nothing wrong with regional theaters, but, you know, I wanted to have a career of it. And, you know, as I was talking with Frankie last time, I kind of have not for the past 20 years or so, almost 20 years. But in the same respect, like I've had a very rewarding career in and of itself, and I'm planning to get back in acting. So to make a short story long, 2 years.
Andy, it's good enough.
Yeah. Andy, did you have a question about his major in college?
Yeah. What is like the best thing to go to college for, like for acting?
If you want to do acting, and that's all you want to do, and you don't want to have a backup or anything, then you want to go for your BFA in acting. Don't go for a BA in theater. Go for your Bachelor of Fine Arts in acting. But while you're there, not only do theater and do as much theater as you can in and around your school. Because like when I was at Ithaca, I was doing theater in the town as well as doing whatever I could on school grounds, whether through the major theater, through the theater school or somebody staging something on their own. But make friends, not only in the theater, because theater majors can get very insular and just kind of only stick to themselves. But I made sure not to do that. Do your best to make friends with people in the radio, film, and TV school, if they have one there, and do your best to not only do theater, but to broaden your horizons into those areas as well. As because of what I did, I got to do a radio play, which I had a lot of fun doing. I did a couple of TV shows for our college TV channel. I did a couple of student films that gave me experience in front of camera in that aspect. And I had a friend who was a DJ on the campus radio, and I got to sit in with him a few times and do some guest spots and just have fun and kind of learn that aspect of things. But I would say get your BFA. You'll get the best training in that. More often than not, they'll have you audition to get in there. And some schools like Ithaca, if you don't keep up with the BFA, you know, they can drop you if they don't think that you're going to. They'll drop you down to a BA theater. I went in and you'd still have to audition for – probably depending on what school that you go to. I had to audition. I wanted to be a BA theater because I also wanted to minor in something and have kind of a background. And I'd been acting all my, like, it's not like I hadn't had acting lessons beforehand. It was more to kind of keep the muscles going. And at the same time, be able to experiment with what I wanted. But if you're going to do the BFA theater, you're going to get, it's going to be BFA acting. That is going to be completely acting intensive. With the BA theater, I learned how to stage manage. I learned how to work in, you know, costuming and all the background stuff for theater as well. It was kind of like more of a general, like, here's kind of everything that has to do with theater. I had a great school. I had a great theater history. I learned a lot of great theater history. Like, it just was a lot. So, but like I said, you want to be intensive, go for the BFA and don't look back. and work your butt off to get it. You know, they may have you do a, you know, I had to audition with a monologue just to get into the VA program. You know, learn your classics, learn your Shakespeare, learn your Marlowe, learn your Greek plays, but also don't let that, don't stay away from more modern stuff as well. And find out what works for you, what speaks to you. I told my wife, I told Valerie years ago, I thought a great monologue for her because of her personality is, you guys know Glengarry Glen Ross, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the coffee is for closers, closers,
baby.
That whole speech, I thought, you know, Alec Baldwin did it in the film, but I told Val flat out, I'm like, that, you could totally kill that monologue. It doesn't matter that you're a woman, anybody could be that part. Mm-hmm. But, and you know, I just think, you know, you got to find what's right for you. And just because you go for a BFA in theater doesn't mean you have to stay in it as a BFA in theater. You can do whatever you want. You can go wherever you want in the school. College to me, I know a lot of people think, listen, I'm not going to get super political here. Because everybody's got their own thoughts on things. But one thing I do hate is when people say, you know, education, it's worthless. It's a scam. It's whatever. Education's like everything else. It's what you put into it, you get out of it. If you put your heart, like I took those 4 years and I knew I was going to be paying for it, but I put everything I wanted into that 4 years and I got out of it everything I wanted. You know, the money was, yeah, it's expensive. Unfortunately, mm-hmm. kind of the pricing of schools right now is expensive. You know, I think it's just like everything else in life. So if that's what you want to do, go for it. But go, like, if you're going to go for it, go for it. Don't look back. Have faith in yourself. Know you can do it. Because if you push and you know you can do it, you'll do it. You'll do it. Well, and you got a great dad, and he'll support you. Even if you got to live at home for the next 40 years afterwards, he'll support you.
Oh, yeah. I don't want her to go. You're right about that. But that was great. Yeah. So, Andy, what about Matt? Do you have a question for Matt?
I gotta hold on.
She wrote down. She prepared.
Is it for Matt or for Jesse Ventura?
which alter ego would you like to talk to?
If you could only see Bruce in concert in one area for the rest of your life, which would it be and why?
Yeah, in what arena?
Madison Square Garden. Not even close. I shouldn't say that, but in the United States, I mean, Madison Square Garden is, for, I would say, any band, not just Bruce Springsteen, is probably, you've made it as a band. You know, it's middle of New York City, has everything. Like, I love the arena and the history, and I know I've gotten into that previously, where there's just so much, the sight line. I mean, I haven't been back since they've done the remodel, but I love Madison Square Garden. Like, that's just, it's a great place to see him. You can feel the energy. And I mean, yes, I have seen him many, 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 many times. But you can tell when he's in his element, you know, New York, New Jersey area, where you feel the energy, it's palpable. You feel that songs take another level up, or the opening is another level up. The encores are a level up. The middle of the show is a level up. And you look at things like that, that you're just like, wow, I just saw something that I haven't seen before. You know, it's not just Bruce. You know, there's other bands that I know over the years that have done it too. You know, you can go to Elton John. Chris Zaha will love this. Billy Joel, because, you know, he'll get excited over, you know, me saying Piano Man by Billy Joel and all the other stuff. But, you know, it's just, the garden is amazing. I mean, and I've known other people that have seen him in Europe and other places where, you know, Sweden is a big area for him, in Norway. Like, I think he's one of their top, he's one of the top selling artists, you know, in the Nordic countries, which is pretty amazing. And I know, I've known friends that have, you know, swore it was like Jesus touched them on, you know, Jesus touched them on the face as, you know, they were watching the show, and it was, you know, pretty epic. And, but no doubt, would be Madison Square Garden for me. And to me, it's, and I'm not the guy who has, I have reverence for things, but seeing it and experiencing it, you know, I've seen them there, I think 3 or 4 times just in Madison Square Garden alone. It's just on a different level. It's an experience that I'll never, ever forget.
Okay. Andy, look at your text I just sent you.
Okay.
My sweet kid. I love her.
She's a great kid.
Yeah, she's awesome.
Don't become a stage parent, though. Don't become a helicopter parent,
Frankie.
What's a stage parent?
That's someone who gives up their day job to basically manage their kid. Let them live their life. You know what I mean? Like, why don't are you getting like that commercial? We gotta eat tomorrow. Yeah, the reason we're not making rent is because you didn't get that TV show, kid. Not because I can't go out and get a job myself.
Don't you do know, that. I already sort of am, Rick. You know, she's not going to school next year. She's staying at home and doing online school. So that she can do all these extra classes like she's doing a jazz dance class. She's doing her acting. She's doing musical theater.
You better get a cereal commercial where it's all over for you.
If it's another Mikey likes it, he really likes it, you know.
Yeah.
She's in there, baby. She's in there.
Well, I'll share with you guys the video that her school made of, and they worked on this for weeks. And it's her and the other kid that's in her acting class. And so it's just two of them. And they did this big, long thing. And like the guy that owns the school edited it all. And what do you use, Andy? What's it, Final Cut Pro or something?
Yeah, Final Cut Pro.
Yeah, and I'll show that with you guys in the group. But it's pretty awesome what they did. And Andy got to go and watch them show it at a live show that they did. It's like every 6 months they have a recital. And so she got to see people's reactions to the jokes and, you know, and her character and how she played the character. So that was pretty cool.
That's cool. Good for you.
Thanks. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah, keep on chasing the dream. Keep on chasing the dream. I don't know if you heard my time on Frankie with Frankie the last time, but, you know, I've enjoyed every bit of my journey, and I hope you do the same. And just know if you need any more questions asked, I'll be here.
That's really nice, you, Rick. Great. Really nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, Andy. We'll see you, baby.
Bye. Bye.
Yeah, she's a good kid. I'm really lucky.
It's over now. Our content's lost.
I'm lucky to have the two that I got. I mean, they're absolutely awesome.
Yeah, I'm lucky you have the two that you got too, and I don't have any. I'm kind of happy with that. No, I'm just kidding.
you know, before I met my wife, I was the exact same way. I was thankful I didn't have any. I was thankful it was just me and my dog, and but then it was just like everything just completely turned around. It's like I got a smart, successful wife. And then she's got these two awesome kids that don't require a lot of work. I mean, they're just good the way that they are. You know, and it's funny, you're talking about school, and, you know, my wife wouldn't have been able to have the success that she has if she didn't have a degree. She has a degree in psychology, so do I. But you know, she wouldn't have been able to move up the ladder if she didn't have that 4-year degree. And then in order to And there's a guy that she hired that we used to work with, and he's up like as high as he goes until he finishes his 4-year degree, you know. Yeah. And that's I'm glad that you said that. Yeah.
Like I said, you know, it's easy. It's easy. People, you know, I know this is a wrestling show, but It's easy because I think people like things to be black and white, and the world is so many shades of gray.
Man,
that was
the hardest lesson for me in life to learn.
Yeah, and I can understand it. Sorry, yeah. I'll shut up. You go.
No, just because I'm a black and white guy, and I was in the military for 5 years, and so everything you either right or you're wrong. That's what I was going to say, and so it was hard once I got out of the military to go, oh my gosh, everything is gray. I mean, everything is gray area.
Yeah, I mean. It's so many shades of gray. It's really easy to, you know, point the finger at someone or anything and just be like, you know, that is a failure or that is bad or this is that. I just think, you know, especially with school, you know, I'm not saying it's for everybody. I'm not that mm-hmm. guy. I don't think everybody needs to go to college. But I think if you do go to college, I think it's like everything else. You got to put 100% in. You know, Ric Flair wrote it in his book. Let's get this to wrestling a little bit. You know, when he told his dad, you know, he wanted to become a wrestler, and his dad said, you know, okay, well, do what you want to do, just be the best at it. And, you know, that's, I really feel like, you know, you may be a ditch digger for your career, but you know what? Ditch diggers are just as necessary as heart surgeons in our society, you know? And if you're going to be a ditch digger, be the best damn ditch digger you can be, you know, just be the best. I'm certainly not the best post supervisor. I've had some issues this past week with my shows that are like, but I'm trying to be the best I can be, you know, I'm trying to be the best at it. You know, I think the world is a lot of, you know, it happens upon your perspective, and there's lots of shades of gray, and you can do any. I'm very much a person who thinks you can do anything you put your mind to. Just give it 100%, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes there's stuff outside standing in your way, but you know, you can only control what you can control.
Best advice I ever got: anyone can cook. It was the most simplistic saying I ever heard. I just started here, I'd been here for 3 years, and he told me that, and it made sense. Just absolutely made sense. Anyone can cook. And I'm just like, shit, it's that simple? I'm like, well, and you get motivated enough to where you get your mind to a point to where it's like, even if you fail, you're still moving forward. And that to me is probably the most important thing. And, you know, I think everyone struggles with that. It's one of those things that, you know, it's another mental hurdle. It's like a mental wall that you have to break through or climb over, you know, and we all struggle with it. We all have our, you know, bugaboos and bullshit that we always go back to. We have our biases. We have, you know, it's my favorite saying is, you know, from people who, you know, get withdrawn and kind of bitter. They're just like, well, it's not who you know. You know, it's not what you know. It's who you know. And I'm like, no. Some people will have an easier time than others, but you worry about you, and everything else a lot of times takes care of itself, because if you outwork people and you bust your ass and you have belief that you can do it. I mean, the industry I'm in, I've been in this 7.5 years. I came in knowing diddly squat, and I am the best person they have. Whether they want to agree with it or not, I don't give a shit. But I will tell you straight up, I'm good with people. I help people. I do what I do. And I knock them in, knock them out, and I'm done. They're happy. I'm happy. You know, and we all have our days where we're not at our best. But you know what? We learn from those, and we keep moving forward. It's the best it can be.
Matt, are you an anesthesiologist? Because you're not going to be in to knock them out?
Well,
no, he hits him with his balls.
It'll be, of course. I was waiting for Rick. Are we going to set the record for my fucking testicles being the punchline? Because God damn it, it's brilliant. It's fun, and we're gonna have we're gonna have to go to the plastic surgeon to remove the goddamn smiles off our faces. That's literally.
I may be. We may be the only people who think it's funny from the group anymore, it's fucking hilarious.
It's hilarious because, I mean, God rest Joe Christie's soul, wherever he is. I miss him, and I fucking wish he was still here. And
yeah.
You know, if there's ever a goddamn instance where life is not fair, you know, you can always go to that. But the fact Barry had to deal with the shit, you know, he brought it out there. Yeah, I dump on fucking lawns after I have Ethiopian food. This is wonderful. This is magnificent. And you know what? I'm just like, and I'm piling up too. I'm not like, mama don't raise no fools. I'm just going to go right the fuck in there and I don't care. You know what? And Rick just comes back. I'm taking up for Barry. I've went out to dinner with Barry. I'm going to fucking talk about this guy's balls. And you know what? We're going to make it happen, damn it. And it's funny. It's stupid, superfluous bullshit. And that is what makes the group fun. And, you know, things where it's like, because trust me, we've all had a fucking crazy 2.5 years. And you know what?
You're not kidding.
You need to laugh. You need to get some of the tension out because, you know what, hey. We're all dealing with things in our lives. We try our best to, you know, move forward and do the best we can. But, you know, laugh. Fucking have fun. You know, it's just like there's too much other BS in the world that you want to worry about and go completely nuts over. But when you laugh, it gets you out of that. It moves you to a different place. And you can come back into polite society and you'll be fine.
Yeah, look at this. Frankie hasn't been involved in the discussion. Oh, he's you people on the podcast. You can't see this now, but Frankie Seacrest has gotten up with his seat.
We're peeling back the curtain. It's like the Wizard of Oz. Nothing to
Rick
see.
Rick Nathan and Matt Crowder are now running this podcast. Ariel Bologna and Cheese Fett Sandwich couldn't even be bothered to show.
Bologna, Zaha. Baby, a bologna and cheese, baby. You know, it's just like
Chris Zaha got lost in a waiting pool full of pudding. He's fallen asleep in a waiting pool full of pudding. Fuck. We have taken control of this hour.
Well, yeah, we've outer limits it. That's what's going to happen. And, you know, Frankie's just like, it's almost fucking midnight. So let's just have these two marks talk about bullshit for the next 3 hours. So I can either take a nap.
He's back.
Oh, he's good. But
Poor Frankie. He's got to be up late to accommodate us assholes.
Before. I mean, the Zaha episode was so goddamn funny for one reason. The guy wasn't even at his house. He was on his phone in the car, just driving around suburban Illinois, you know, and then, oh yeah, I got to deal with this bullshit about a door at work. And I'm just, oh fuck. It was him in a nutshell in every situation possible. And that's just what made it great.
Frankie, we can't hear you.
Sorry, that's my fault. So if you guys see me running around my dog, the old man is out of sorts. And so I heard him, and that's why I pulled my headphones off, because I could hear him whining in the bedroom with Jana. So I went and got him, and I brought him out here. And I doped him up, because sometimes at night he's going blind. So they said that he sleeps too much during the day. And so he thinks that nighttime is the daytime, so he wants to be up. So I doped him up, and now he's like walking around like Bambi on our floors that are slick. And so I just put him outside, so maybe he'll use the bathroom and come in and go out. So if you see me disappear, just pretend like I didn't disappear, because I just was trying to get this old man to settle down and be quiet.
Sounds Don't like worry, a coke addict. He just, you know, took a line and, you know, he slept during the day. It's like I always say, I'm like, you just have a line of coke. You're up for 6 weeks and you sleep for 6 months. It's a beautiful thing. You know what? You get everything out of it.
Yeah. You want to dope him up good, just have him listen to Zaha singing, and that'll put him right in. I love you, Chrissy Poo. We don't have any heat.
Kayfabe, brother. Kayfabe. Oh, Jesus. Him could be like the center of any, I would say, at this point. Two-thirds of all of Frankie's guests have brought up probably Chris Zaha at some point in any sort of conversation. Whether it's music, wrestling, real life, fat marks, you know, whatever the fuck. It's just that's the way it is.
Well, there's so many podcasts that'll bring him up too. I mean, like, it's not just this one or Broken Kayfabe. I mean, you hear him.
Well, the fact he big timed Rick, that's there's heat there, brother. It's just like that's a backhanded slap in the face.
What?
Well, I heard you two were gonna be on together, and
when he passed out.
Well, he did it to me and Travis Raines. We gave him shit, and then Chris, I think, felt bad. And then we did ours the next night, which was hilarious. But punch a hole through the wall. It's just like, God damn it, these fuckers. Literally. And then he had the kids, I think, going into the weekend, right?
Yeah.
And he had like probably, I think, 4 or 5 hours of sleep each night. It's just like, God, can this end? And Chris, you know, made that known throughout the goddamn taping, and I'm just like, Frankie's indifferent. He's getting content.
Well, you know, I'm on the cusp of being an introvert and an extrovert. You know, I'm right there, so I can be a INTP or ENTP. And so sometimes if I'm in a group and there's a bunch of eyes, I'll just shut up and listen to them. And so people, like in college and then when I was in the military, they would say, why are you being so quiet? Why are you being so quiet? Like, and it was just either I have nothing to add to the conversation, or it's like I just don't have the energy to talk over everybody else or interject. So I'll just shut up and let people who know what they're talking about talk, or you know, if it's a subject I don't have anything to comment on. And so that was the case. I was exhausted because I stayed up the night before, and then I had to get up early the next morning to take the kids to school. And so I only had 3 or 4 hours of sleep, and then I got up and I just did the repeat of it. So I did it with Matt and Travis Raines one night, and then Matt and Chris Zaha on the next night.
That was fun. Travis was great. Chris was, you know, Chris, he just goes, you know, you just feed him and he just goes on a tangent, and that's, you know, that's the best 1-2 combo in the business, like literally. But I can empathize with Frankie. I'm the same way. I'll get into a point where I'll shut the fuck up, and the conversation's so good you don't want to ruin that. Even though you're not, you're kind of getting the vibe of that conversation, and you're getting so much out of it, because sometimes just being an active listener, you get so much more out of with you not flapping your gums. Flapping your gums, you know, and stuff like that, where it's makes I would say the moment so much more meaningful. It's just like there's lots of times where I haven't said 5 fucking words, and I'm just like, God, this is really nice. Where it's just like you want to be away from people for a while, and you're just like, I'm fucking done. I'm checking out for a little bit. So I'll be over here if you really want to get a hold of me. Just figure something out and we'll be fine.
Well, that's what I experienced at the Fan Fest. Have either of you been to like a wrestling convention or a Fan Fest? Or
I've only been to like Comic-Con stuff. I've never been to a Fan Fest or a wrestling convention.
Do Comic-Cons usually have like question and answer sessions and stuff too? Or
yeah, I mean you can get into panels and stuff, and I mean you can go up and meet people. If you wait in line and do that, I went because I've had friends who've written comics and, you know, been there getting a booth and selling them. And I normally don't really, I mean, I probably would do a wrestling convention or two, but it's, you know, you go to one of those comic cons and you've been to one, you go to a couple of them and you kind of seen it all. And it's just like, I don't think I don't really need to do it more than once, you know? Mm-hmm. I wrestling conventions, I imagine, would be a little different. I really like, I want to do the Lutz, Fan Fest for sure. No. And I know I'm talking a lot. I'm not an introvert, as you guys probably know. I am definitely much an extro. So you can always tell me to shut the fuck up and Rick, you're talking too much. So.
God damn it. Stop talking. Just kidding. But, well, you know, I was, you know, and thinking about your first line to me, when I dropped the Spielberg line, I'm mad I didn't use the Herb Abram line, "Let's hear it for the Jews," which would have probably, which would have fucking ended the goddamn thing, which still makes me laugh to this day because the dude was so fucking coked up. And, you know, the way he died, like, you know, blowing baby. Good God. You can't buy a better story than that.
No, but man, Jews and my people in the wrestling industry, what, I mean, you look at all the people, it's like Dean Malenko and Dean and Jody Malenko and Barry Horowitz are like the three I'm like, you've never heard a bad thing about them. Like, everybody has different opinions on Goldberg. Herb Abrams was a freaking maniac. You know, it's just like,
Is he Slapowitz?
Is he? Yeah, I'm sure there's stuff about Izzy. I mean, he wrestled for the, you know, the Poffos. That was kind of outlaw, you know. Or he managed, right, for them, not wrestled for them, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
The Grand Wizard, he was Jewish. Ernie Roth. But, you know, few and far between.
You know, somebody asked the Masked Superstar about Ernie Roth, and I was hoping for more. And he said, you know, he just showed up for TV. He didn't make the arenas. And I was just really hoping, I mean, because everybody always puts him over as being, you know, great. And it's like when someone's, you hear about somebody so great, it's like, I want to hear, like, what was it about them that was so great? But, you know, Bill Eddy was just like, I didn't spend a lot of time with him. He just showed up for the TV tapings and you know.
And, yeah, but
go ahead.
Sorry. No, I think that's how it was with WWWF and WWF at the time. I think him, Blassie, and Albano, they just showed up for the tapings, and then they did not go on the road with the guys they were managing. It wasn't like, you know, I look at like what managers were like, real managers, like Paul Ellery. That guy was a manager in every sense of the word. Jimmy Hart, that guy was a manager in every sense of the word. You know, I don't know how much, you know, Heenan did to, well, I read his book. I just can't remember what he did to kind of like actually manage. Corny was very much a manager, you know?
You know, Corny in itself, my God. Yeah. That's a book, a movie, and a miniseries all rolled into one.
You know, I love listening to that guy. And I was telling Barry when he was out here, you know, out of all the podcasts I've ever listened to, Corny is the one who has turned ad reading into an art form of itself.
It's,
you know?
When you can have a freaking omnibus of his ad reads, some of them are just so fucking ridiculous. But they tickle you and you don't even notice it. That's the thing. It's he may fuck up the transition into it, but then he'll just go off on this tangent. I mean, that's his gift. Yeah. I mean, literally, that is his gift.
But, yeah, I'm sorry I interrupted you, Frankie, when you were talking about Ernie Roth. And Bill Eady is someone who I would love to meet. He's had two different careers in the industry, you know, like the Masked Superstar is no joke. Like what a great wrestling, you know, what a great gimmick. And he was so good in that. And then, you know, Demolition, I mean, I have nothing but fond memories of Demolition. You know, it was fun. I was a kid. They were awesome, you know?
Well, we had the third part, which was one of the Mongols. You know, which is kind of where he got his start, because I think if I remember the story correctly, Nikolai Volkov, who was the one, got hurt. And so Bill Eady was offered to jump in there and stay. And and actually he's like one of the guys that no one ever says anything bad about. Right. And that's what I told both of them, because when I go up and meet these people, I don't know what the hell to say. I just feel like whatever I say, I'm going to be an idiot. So I just come out and say whatever it is. And I said, I'm so thankful that you two are two guys that no one has anything bad to say about, you know, because
absolutely.
You look at your other heroes, like Eddie Gilbert. There's plenty to say about him, who's one of my favorites. I don't know. Chris Benoit was one of my favorites. You can't say anything positive about that dude now. You know, so it's just like, here you've got, and that's extreme, but like Bill Eadie's a family man, been a family man. Barry Darso, I'm assuming the same way. And you listen to Arn Anderson's podcast, he talks about Barry Darso is one of his best friends.
Yeah, I work with Barry Darso's nephew back in my sales days.
Oh, really? Which,
yeah, no, he is funny. He was dating this Canadian model at the time. She was on a 10, she was a 12. I mean, she was gorgeous. And he had the Canadian, like, you could tell the Canadian be like process or any other words that will out you as a Canadian.
Again.
Yeah, again. Pretty much. And he's a young kid, great. Nothing bad to say about him, but he's just like, yeah, if you ever want my uncle's autograph, you know, let me know. You've heard it all. And I'm like, yeah, that's nice. You know, because if I'd have been there, I'd have been like, yeah, I worked with Jacob Darso. How is he doing? I haven't seen him in 10 years, but I hope he's doing well.
Mm.
But yeah, no, that was like 6 degrees of separation, which I still find comical to this day.
Nice. That's cool, man.
Well, at the fan fest, Barry came down at breakfast, and I've never been one to rush the people and ask questions. It's like I sat there the whole time he was there and he was talking and whatever, and I could not think of one question to ask him, you know, except for, hey, what do you think of the hotel? You know, I mean, that's about all I got. I can't think of how'd you like wearing those cutoff jean shorts in Mid-South? I don't know.
Come on. God. Yeah. But you know, that's a real question too. Like, you know, it's not a stupid question. How'd you like the hotel? You know, that's a real question. You're talking to them on a real human level. You know, I have it too, where it's like, you know, I've worked around quite a bunch of celebrities and some I'm just like fine with and I'm like okay with. And then there's some who've been kind of like people I looked up to who, you know, you just kind of get that nervousness around, you know, and they're just, a lot of them are just real people just trying to live their lives too. You know, Barry Darso could have had a bad night's sleep on his mattress. He might actually have something to say about how he likes the hotel, you know? So, you know, I don't think that's a dumb question in the slightest, you know?
Well, let me call them icebreakers, Frankie. It's just like, hey, the weather is always good. And then there's other ones, even though a lot of times people will say, well, why the fuck would you ask that? And I'm like, you know what? It snowballs, starts to go in another direction. You get a like, you get something that you can kind of sink your teeth into. And after that, the rest is history.
Well, he sat there probably, I don't know, 30 minutes and ate his breakfast and everybody talked. And then when Bill Eadie came down with his family, he went and he joined them. And it was more interesting for me to see people interacting with him than it was for me to ask a stupid question. And it's it was just so cool that these guys, like one of them is Drew Samuels. Drew Samuels, all weekend long, was like a kid in a candy store. There's no other way that I can describe it. But that energy that he had, where he was so excited about it, that conveyed over to everybody else, right? And it's like,
that's cool.
Yeah. You can have someone who goes in and it's like, oh, I've met all these guys, I don't give a shit, right? And that energy also carries on to other people. But to see Drew so happy and giddy and like a kid, it really made everyone else feel good. So he's there asking questions and you know, interacting. And then when Barry leaves, he's like, man, that was so cool. That was something I did not expect to happen, you know, this morning. I didn't think that I would get to meet anybody outside the fan fest.
That's cool. I would definitely like to do a wrestling thing. Like the Comic Cons, I couldn't compare the two, because like with Comic Con, it's like, or any of those things, you, by the time you see your 50th Captain America, you know what I mean? You're kind of like, okay, I get it. But I mean, there's only one Barry Darso. There's only one Bill Eadie, you know, it's only one Barry Windham. You're not getting another. So, you know, it was interesting and I wanted to kind of bring it up, because when Barry Rose was out here and we had dinner with him. he was talking to me about the upcoming, like, the ideas very loosely. Like, I don't know anything, you know, that nobody else doesn't know. But he was kind of asking me, he's like, who would you like to meet for a fan fest? And I was trying to think, and I was thinking about just, like, so many guys that I want to meet are just gone, you know? But I came to it, and I thought that, you know, if I could have the choice to kind of sit and talk with anybody right now that they, I don't know if they've had or haven't had, I would probably choose Jesse Ventura.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm not even joking. I'm just like, that guy's had, he's had such an interesting life, and he continues to be a voice. And there's just stuff that, like, because I'm always, like, looking on YouTube for, you know, old wrestling I haven't seen. And I'm like, you know, I saw an interview with him. Like, he was a face in Portland when he was, like, when he was super young. Like, I can't even imagine what that's like. I'd love to talk to him about that, you know. And
who's that, Raven?
There. No, Jesse Ventura. Like, I was saying, like, that's the guy I was thinking about most, like, now. That would still kind of have it together. Like, you know, Barry was saying that Don Morocco can't, you know, fly anymore, and he's really kind of experiencing issues with his body and stuff. And it's just like a lot of these guys are breaking down. And I mean, the way Cornette talks about the ring that WWF had, if they worked in WWF, it sounds like that ring did a lot of damage to their bodies, you know?
Well, yeah. Yeah. Shit. I forgot where I was going with that.
I'll chime in. I mean,
go ahead.
Jesse, here's the thing. I have an I love Jesse as a kid, and, you know, into probably my early 20s. I mean, now he's in his compound in Mexico, and, you know, spouting off what he's spouting off. And like I said, I'm not going to get into that, but you know, yes. Jesse as a commentator and as a heel, even though everyone says he's the shits as a worker. Mother guy was entertaining as hell. Like, I still contend he should have beat Hogan if he didn't have the blood clots. And then him and Hogan have a program, you know, in 84 till just before WrestleMania. Because you have to have Piper and Hogan. I mean, that's just the way it is. But Jesse would probably be too expensive just based on who he is. I just don't know if Barry and – I mean, Cash Money pins are – I don't know is going to Doyle out the C notes enough to bring Jesse out of the bunker in Mexico. But I mean, to me, it's, he's so much out for money, and he's an interesting guy. But he is a money guy. Like, he wants money, and he makes no bones about it. And, you know, it's like, Jesse would be a great person, but I don't know how much non-kayfabe and kayfabe Jesse Ventura you're going to get. Which would be kind of annoying, because it's like Frankie says, it's like you have people that are going to be interesting and going to give you, they're not going to always give you like the unvarnished, like, yeah, when I was there, this is what I was feeling, blah, blah, blah. You get that from some people who just don't give a shit anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I ain't looking for a job. I don't care who I piss off. I don't care what you think.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's a delicate line to do. I mean, it's really hard now. And Rick, you're absolutely on the ball. Like, who do you want to meet that's left? And I mean, I met Jesse at a Monday Nitro in 1998 during his governor campaign. I have one of his campaigns.
Oh, wow.
I think I still have it somewhere where he, like, a campaign sign, and I still have his campaign shirt, Retaliate 98. That's like three sizes too big, but I don't fucking care. I'm never going to get rid of it until the day I die. But, you know, and then he came to my high school. I did an impression in front of him, in front of the entire school, which made the local paper. My parents were proud. And everything else, and it was funny, and you know, he made a comment and that was fine. But is looking at him, his body work is great, but the person now, I don't know, is going to be as interesting. He would probably push on to people, be like, hey, look into my project here, look into my project there now.
Yeah, than I mean, to be fair, it's really been like genuine curiosity with him.
Ariel, I'm always very thankful when the Brothershippers take the time to come on our podcast and talk. You know, this podcast is important to me because I feel like the Brothershippers were sort of a family and they're friends. And it's kind of like when I have someone on, it's like I'm saying to the world, hey, come meet my friend and learn about my friend because they're so cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we all are. I mean, it is a brothership. We joke with each other like we're, you know, siblings. The camaraderie when you guys get together at the fan fest is unlike any other convention. I mean, you know, it's one of a kind, and I love it. And it's great, you know, listening to other brothershippers get on here and talk about their stories and stuff that you've never really known about them. So it's really nice to have to have this. I can't even talk today because I'm so like trying to think of what to say. But what I want to say is like it's very, very nice of you to come up with this podcast to give the Brothershippers a voice to, you know, talk about their lives and their love for wrestling and food and any other thing that they're in love with, like Bruce Springsteen, for instance, and Matt's genitalia. But no, it's but you know, it's a great thing. Thank you, Frankie the Tanky.
Should
call you that.
Don't get me in the feels. So
I'm sorry.
we had a eventful week in the wrestling business, and so let's just take a few minutes and let's discuss that. So sure. One thing I want to talk about with the group, and one of the things that makes the group so good are the moderators. And I say it all the time. You know, I really put them over because they keep out the riffraff. And on our last podcast, I talked about, you know, my pink cheese, green ghost comment and, you know, how it almost landed me in hot water. So I had to edit it and be a little creative with it. Right.
Yeah.
Well, this time I almost started something within our own group, and I sent you the text, but let me just recap for those who missed it. Right. So I posted and I said, if anyone is on eBay bidding against me on the huge lot of AWA programs, please stop. I'm buying them to give them away to the Brothership, you jerk. Obviously joking, right?
Obviously.
Right?
Yeah, of course.
And look, I am not a collector. The only thing that I will collect and keep is the Mass Superstar stuff that I just got signed because he is my number one favorite of all time. Mm-hmm. So I literally was, and I had sent them, I think, to Chris Zaha, maybe mentioned on the Matt Crowder, because I knew those were AWA guys, right? And I was like, man, yeah, we'll spread them out. I don't want them. So I watched these things go from, you know, 50 to 100, and then Matt Crowder jumped in after I was out. I think I got out at, like, 175, and he went up to, like, I don't know, 250 or something, and they end up selling at, like, 325.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Well, in the meantime, someone comments on my post and says, OMG, grow up. And so I come back with a joke. Hey, I've been trying to grow up for 49 years. I can't seem to grow up. Can you give me some advice on how to grow up?
Mm-hmm.
So this guy comes back. First things first, usually by the time you're 14 or 15, you realize no one owes you anything. And you need to start accepting that. Yeah. I was like, okay, so this guy's, you know, a bit of a jerk. And so I come back with, really? I'm not entitled to anything? Oh, damn. I'm so far behind the curve. Please continue to enlighten me. Because I thought I would be entertained by this person who was upset, obviously, over nothing, unless he was a person that was trying to get these, you know.
Yeah.
Which I doubt. I looked at his profile. I doubt he was spending $300 on AWA programs. However, and then one of the moderators jumped in and said, hey, rule number one, don't be an asshole and make sure we don't have the issue. And so this guy responds to the moderator, the wonderful, loving guy, Michael Harris, says, then why hasn't he been removed?
Yeah.
Meaning me.
Right.
Me. I posted as a joke. I did not expect anyone to stop bidding for me. Actually, I sort of did. Because you know what would make sense if you know that there's two people that are bidding for the same thing? Is saying, hey, let's just split them. And you get half and I get half, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the cost is half and you get half. You don't actually need all of those, especially when I'm just going to give them away. And so yeah. the guy wants me kicked out. And then a few minutes later, Michael says, okay, that guy's booted from the group. I guess they had a side discussion, but pretty crazy, right? I mean, the guy coming after me, like I'm entitled, like I am entitled.
Like yeah, and you were being sarcastic the entire time, and I guess that flew over that person's head.
I'm really curious. When someone gets all upset about people being entitled, I really want them to explain, you know, how is someone entitled? Tell me how what I posted makes me entitled. Yes, I know. It's a free country, capitalist, number one country in the world, hoorah, all that good stuff. However, there was some good nature behind what I was saying, right? It was just, right. Hey, come on, don't bid against me. I mean, it's a free country. Do what you want. You can bid against me all you want. I don't understand what in that made me entitled. I didn't say, hey, I'm owed these, so everyone stop bidding against me. And also, the likelihood of the person that was bidding against me, and this was real time, so this was like, you know, 3 or 4 hours left to go. The likelihood that someone is in our group that's bidding against me is very, 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 very small. Right.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So anyway, I was just having a little fun, but when this person goes and says I'm entitled, I mean, gosh, please tell me how I'm entitled. Please tell me what you know about me, sir, that I've never interacted with on Facebook that says that I am entitled. And please tell me how I can be a better person and grow up. Tell me how to grow up. You know, you're going to tell someone to grow up. Tell me how do I mature? Maybe I am entitled. Can you tell me how to not be entitled? If you can't, then you need to shut up. That's the truth.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, when someone does something wrong, you can't just say, hey, you did that wrong, dumbass. You have to say, hey, you did it wrong, but here's how you can do it right. Here's an example. My son stripped a screw on something on his car, and he was working on it, and I wanted to help him. You know, because I get the joys out of teaching my kids to do stuff. But my kid's almost 16. And you remember when you're 16, you think you know freaking everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so whenever my son thinks he knows everything, it means he's right about to strip a screw. So he stripped a screw and annoyed the heck out of me. But I had to teach him a lesson, right? So the lesson is, you know, don't strip the screw. Next time, don't use the drill to try and take the screw off. Hand loosen it so that you don't strip it, because using a drill, if it just spins in there, it's going to strip it. So I didn't just tell him don't strip the screw. I told him how to take a screw off the right way the next time so that he doesn't strip it. And so I don't have to use a Sawzall just to cut the screw out, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's my point. You know, if you give, this is Frankie's advice tip for the day. And then we'll move on to the news of the week. You know, if you're giving someone some advice, or you're telling someone, hey, don't do that, do this or whatever, you got to explain that to them and not just say, don't do this. I mean, that's like 1940s and 50s, right? Parenting. It's, hey, don't do that. Why? Because I told you to.
Yeah.
I mean, that shit never worked. It did, because your parents would end up eventually hitting you. You're like, oh, so I don't do it because if I do, you'll hit me. Okay, that makes more sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
So that's the first bit of drama. That was kind of funny. And I thank the moderators for keeping the assholes out. I really, 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 really do.
Yeah, I've never seen that guy. I've never seen his posts before. I don't think I recall seeing his posts. So, I mean, you know, I mean, I don't know how often he checked the group and how often, you know, he saw any of your posts, or I don't know. It's just, it was just kind of weird. I missed out on it.
I thought he was a troll. I thought he was a troll.
Probably, yeah. I've never seen him before.
Well, I thought like he made a new account. Like he's someone that is familiar to us, if you know what I'm saying, who just made an account. But I looked and that profile was made in 2008. So I was like, all right. Okay. But looking at his Facebook profile of the things that I could see, you know, not being friends with him, I could see he's a pretty miserable person. So anyway, thank you, you know, moderators, Travis Raines, Mark Hertwig, Michael Herrick, for all that you do of keeping us, you know, I don't want to say safe, but, you know, keeping the riffraff out. I really appreciate it. You know, and I don't talk about the stuff that I do often, but I did send the moderators a gift because I know that they're not making the big bucks moderating this thing. So I sent each of them a gift. I sent Michael and Travis some cupcakes from Wicked Good Cupcakes. And Mark Hertwig said he's not into the cupcakes. So I sent him the Bruiser Brody book.
Oh, wow. Awesome. That's awesome.
Because, you know, yes, I like to say thank you, but sometimes, you know, it's better to say thank you and give someone's belly full.
Yeah. That's a good way of saying it. Yeah, that's true.
You know, our brothership likes to eat.
Yeah, they do. Apparently, look at us. I mean, than others. But yeah, we do love to eat.
So, the news of the week. Why don't you tell us about some wrestling news?
Why me? Okay, so
I just did a big mouthful, you know. More and more often I'm doing these old man rants, but anyway,
you know, I'm getting there. I'm getting to those rants too. I'm just more profane, and I'm just more profane at it than you are. let's see. So the big news of the wrestling world this past week is, of course, the scandal of which Vince McMahon allegedly paid $3 million in hush money to, you know, a former employee. I guess it was a paralegal, right? I'm not sure.
Yep.
And
she was, and then she got a better job.
And she got a better, okay.
So a paralegal making $100,000. I don't know how that compares, but it seems like kind of high for a paralegal, but anyway,
yeah.
And then she got bumped up to do something else, I think, for Johnny Laurinaitis. Mm-hmm. And so she went from, I got $100,000 to a $200,000. I mean, that's a hell of a pay raise.
And that was within a matter of months, right? Or was it like a year?
I think she had been there the year, coming a year, but mm-hmm. but either way, you know, she goes from $100,000 to $200,000.
Yeah. That's pretty quick. But the big issue is, was the money from the company? Was it from Vince himself? That's the investigation, supposedly. And then Stephanie McMahon, who exited the company a couple weeks ago, probably last month, is now the interim CEO, which is kind of weird to me also. I mean, like, she left, she came back. I don't know what's going on. Lots going on within that company right now that they're still investigating with or trying to sort out. And also, was it Kevin Dunn with the insider trading accusations or allegations? Right?
Yep.
Yeah, that too. Wow. it's crazy. I haven't really been keeping up other than the initial reports. I don't know if there's anything new that happened within the past couple of days. It seemed to have quieted down a bit. I mean, what do you think?
First of all, I think all that's crazy. I don't think that it should ever, any of those things should ever happen. I don't think you should have to pay hush money to anyone. And I get, so let's take, you know, the other side of the coin. Do people blackmail folks for, you know, hush money? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I don't know the situation here, but I do know that Vince McMahon, you know, being however old he is, should not be dipping his pen in the company ink.
Right, exactly. Which is a bigger issue than whatever he's been doing on the side.
Correct. Correct. Mm-hmm. And as far as we all know, he's still married to Linda.
And I heard they were separated. Right?
Well, they may be. However, he still shouldn't be doing it, right?
Right.
You know, I could tell you that he could go outside the company. You know, there was also another accusation about Vince McMahon a few years ago. Something about a a girl at a tanning salon that he allegedly exposed himself or said something to. And I'm sorry, you know, if you're worried that you're, let's just say, a billionaire, and you're afraid that someone will come after you for hush money, wouldn't you kind of keep yourself out of those situations?
Right.
That's my point. I think he should have never been in there. I don't think that a 76-year-old man should he be having an affair? Yeah, sure, he can have an affair, but he should know better than to do it in his own backyard. You know, I told my kids this past weekend, you know, don't shit where you eat, you know, because my kid's getting to be 16, Alex, and he's going to start running around the neighborhood and going to the beach. And so I said to him, look, it's fine. I get you want to go out and you want to, you know, be mischievous or have fun or whatever. Just don't do it right here where we live. So if you want to be an asshole, go to a different beach. Don't come and be an asshole on our own beach. And, you know, I think he got it. I think that he, I like to think that he got it, and he gets that, you know, you don't have to come and be an asshole around where you live. So it's the same with Vince McMahon. You know, you don't have to dip your pen in the company ink. I've said that 50 times. How about I come up with another analogy? He could have went anywhere else and, you know, I don't know, sugardaddymeat.com or whatever it is, right?
Okay.
He's on the social media, so he could have.
Yeah.
He could have went elsewhere to find him some strange.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
That's true. That is an actual website, huh? Sugardaddymeat.com.
Yeah, I won't tell you on air how I know about it. No, I will.
Yeah, go ahead.
Allegations came out on a political figure, I won't mention their name, that they had been on this website before. Mm. And and so I saw that, and that was actually a website. So you already looked it up, huh?
Yeah.
My man.
Yeah. It's just hilarious.
Yeah.
There's cougarlife.com if you guys are interested in older women looking for younger cubs to take care of. Rawr!
Oh my gosh, you beat me to the rawr!
Rawr.
Oh man. I'd like to know, are any of the younger Brothershippers into the cougars?
I am.
You have a girlfriend.
I know. Wish we're older. No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, the good news, if you marry a girl and you're young, eventually she'll be a cougar.
Yeah. And you know what? I didn't want to tell you this, but you did what I wanted to do in life. When I was younger, I wanted to marry an older woman that already had kids that were like older, so I didn't have to raise any children, you know?
Well, that's an interesting way to put it.
Well, I was a dick back then. So anyway, I wasn't thinking, you know, right. But yeah, that was my dream of marrying like an older woman, preferably a rich woman that had children that were already grown up, preferably moved out already. So, you know, I didn't have to erase them. But, yeah, that was just shitty of me to, you know what? Edit that one out.
So, since you brought that up.
Okay.
Most of my life, I never wanted to be married. I never wanted kids. And then just something switched in my brain. And I was like, I think I should have kids. I think that I think there's a lot of bad kids. I was mentoring some kids, and I knew, I realized no matter what I did, they would turn out with some issues, right? And so I thought, man, I should just have my own kids, right? Mm-hmm. And so that was sort of, so I started thinking, okay, well, let's do it. But I wanted to do it right. My parents were married, you know, from the time they were married to the time my father passed away. So I never wanted to go through a divorce. And I just didn't have the relationships where I felt like it was right. And it could be that maybe I didn't want to put the work in. It could be that, I don't know. I did date a girl with a kid before Jana, and I loved that kid just like I love the two that I have now. But that just didn't. It was the time where I went from working this job that I had with Jana to getting into real estate, and that first year in real estate about killed me. But we'll talk about that another time. So when I had this opportunity, I didn't even think about, oh man, I'm gonna be living in the house with these kids. I didn't think about any of that. It just happened. So they were 10 and 12 when I got them. So when you think about it, I think I may have been 44 at the time. So I had 6 years. I have 6 years with Alex till he turns 18, and I had 8 years with Andy till she turns 18. So I was like, all right. But once I got into it, and I think some other fathers will back me up, this is how you feel. It's like once you get into, and you're like, oh, I'm going to be a parent or a role model or whatever, then it's like kind of the game changes. And it's so fun and interesting to see how much your kids change and how much they learn and the progress that they make. You know, for example, Andy is, she's got anxiety. She's an overthinker. But she's really, you know, she has to have everything right and perfect except for her room, which is a complete mess. But and I never thought that she would be into something like acting. And then this past week, she went to try out this jazz dance class, right, at the same place. And she's never been a dancer. She's had like two dance moves where basically she danced like a toddler, throws her hands in the air and stomps her feet. And she's never been like a dancer. And I thought, well, man, she's not going to like this. And she's all worried about it. She's like, what if all the girls are like more advanced and I'm just the beginner? I'm going to feel dumb. And I'm like, look, you got this. Just go in there. And so she went in there and she nailed it. And as soon as I sat there waiting for an hour, she came out of the class and she is, oh my gosh, I love it. That was so amazing. And so to see her go from sort of being introverted to being on the stage and singing that big Adele song to doing the acting that she's doing and to trying these things that are new, that is just really a great feeling, you know, in my heart, is to see her happy and making this progress and developing into, you know, a mature young woman.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And that's all I got to say about that.
That's good. Yeah, that's different from what I was thinking when I wanted to marry someone older with kids.
Well, I just said that just so that, you know, if you have that opportunity,
yeah,
you know, don't doubt yourself, because, you know, you will be a wonderful dad.
I hope so.
And like, if you're not, then, you know, I mean, there's a ton of other things you can do, you know, mentoring or your niece, And before, you know, before I had kids, I was always the fun uncle, you know. My niece would come and would spend a week or two. I think she spent 3 weeks with me in the summer before I moved here to Florida, down at Curry Beach, North Carolina. And we had a great time and absolutely loved it. So I was, you know, sort of like a father figure to her and the fun uncle. And as a, you know, the uncle, you get to do all the fun stuff with none of the responsibility.
That is true. But a lot of that changed when my niece was born, actually. Kind of, you know, helped raise her for the first 3 years of her life. And I learned how to, you know, essentially not let any... I learned essentially not to let a child die under my watch. You know, that's pretty much it. No, but I learned how to change a diaper. And I learned how to, you know... swaddle a child, a baby, proper heating technique of the formula or something. There's a lot of things I learned when, you know, my niece was a little baby, and it changed a lot of what, it took away a lot of my fears I had with, the prospect of being a father. And, it just, a lot of it for me came naturally. I don't know if it's like that paternal instinct that, you know, we have, I guess, but there were things that came naturally to me, like holding the baby. Like I was so scared when my niece was born that I didn't know how to hold a kid, but you know, I it's like not hard actually. It's, you just have to make sure their neck doesn't, you have to, you know, support their neck and everything and all that. But anyway, the one that scared me the most was changing diapers. And I think I mentioned it on the previous podcast where I was alone with my niece and, you know, everyone was at work and she ended up pooping a lot and I didn't know how to change diapers. So I had to look up, I had to Google how to change a diaper before I changed her. And yeah, that was traumatizing. I was like, oh, wow, why is it so much and why does it smell that way, you know? It was a lot.
What's wrong with this kid?
Yeah, like she just drank milk. Why is it salt? Why are solid waste coming out of a child that just drank only liquid? I was like, I couldn't. And why does it smell so bad? So that was like a reality check for me. And you know, even though I don't like changing diapers, I don't mind doing it. That's my niece. You know, that's something I learned. That's something I don't. It's like a, I'm not going to say I enjoy it. My sister enjoys it for some odd reason. She loves changing her diaper, her daughter's diaper. Hmm. But yeah, I'm not afraid of it anymore. Well, I can't do it now because, I mean, she's older, but back then, that was like one of my biggest fears was changing diapers. I might not know how to do it. I might not secure it correctly. That was my big issue, like trying to make sure it's not too tight, not too loose. Nothing's going to leak out from the side or whatnot. But the internet helped. But yeah, it's now it's, I do want kids one day. I don't know if I don't know. Maybe not. If it's for me, then yeah, that'd be cool. But I'm not going to like rush it or anything, you know?
Yeah. It's not really something that you can rush. And Andy wrote me this birthday card for Father's Day. And it really, gave me insights to how the kids see me, especially Andy, but also, you know, and I'll read that card here in just a second for the folks at home who didn't see my post. She says, "You are the best parent ever, Mom. You got close second. Ha ha ha. You helped me to think of what I should do in a situation. Love you so much, bro. Love, Andy." And then this is what a little shit ass she is. She says, "P.S. Alex," which is her brother, "will not make you a card unless someone tells him to. Ha ha ha. He did not make me a card. But the funny thing is, so Mother's Day was just, you know, last month, right? And mm-hmm. and Andy had made Jenna a card. Alex saw it. And so as we were coming to pick the kids up, Alex took a piece of paper, folded it, you know, used the pen, happy Mother's Day, wrote a little something in there, and then he had it. And Andy was mad. She's like, he wouldn't have done that if he hadn't seen my card. And so that was why she was recalling that joke. Mm-hmm. But so my point in reading that was that, you know, I legitimately just try and help the kids to I give them advice. And I think about, you know, there's a meme that I saw posted that says, be the adult that you needed when you were a kid, or be the person you needed when you were a kid. Right. And that's, mm-hmm. that's what I try and do, is I try and help them. So, but my son is having his first relationship, and they've been talking for 4 months because her mother won't let her go out anywhere with him unless it's a big group of people. Mm. And I guess that she's worried about sex. I guess that's the thought. I don't know, but shouldn't she be worried more about it being a big group? Cause I would be devastated, not if my son had sex, but if his first sexual experience was with a big group of people and it was an orgy. But anyway,
wow. Yeah.
But anyway, so he's having some troubles with the girl, and he is over with his dad, and he texts me what I thought he should do. And I was like, wow, you know, I mean, that made me feel really, really, really good. You know, that, he is, even while he's over there, he is thinking of me and that I'm the one to go to ask questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
So sidetracked. let's talk about Jeff Hardy real quick.
Oh, okay, sure.
That's pretty horrible, huh?
Jeff's gonna Jeff.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it's nothing new with this guy.
But man, I don't want to say I understand addiction because I don't, but I have dated a person that was an addict, and I did get a little insight into it. But man, oh man. Mm. I just don't understand how this guy can drink and drive. I mean, you know, I mean, look at Sonny, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, something has to, like, can't he get someone else to drive him?
I guess not.
I mean, I feel for him, but also, come on, Jeffrey.
Yeah, it's not the first time. He's been through this many, many times. He hasn't learned his lesson, it seems. I feel bad, but at the same time, I'm like, well, this is what you get for doing something stupid over and over again.
Well, you know, thank God that it wasn't an accident. He didn't kill someone.
Yeah, but, you know, but it could have been.
Three times the legal limit? Come on.
Yeah, that's fucking way too much. And, yeah, I'm glad nothing, you know, no accident happened and whatnot. But it's, again, he went to rehab before a couple times, right? For his addictions.
I would think so.
Yeah, I would think so also. But for whatever reason, I don't know. Same thing with Jimmy Uso, who doesn't learn his lesson either. But anyway, that's a different story. But yeah, Jeff, kind of, man, at this point, he should just, I don't know. I mean, have you seen, his matches in AEW? He kind of seems like he's kind of messing up on his swantons look like it's hurting him
more than the other person.
The other person. It's just a matter of time where an accident could happen. And I don't know, he needs to just step away and concentrate on himself again.
Well, you know, here's the other thing too, mm-hmm. is that, and I hope that no one thinks that I'm like, oh, holier than thou, but he's a father, and I'm assuming still a husband, but hey, man, you got kids.
Right.
You got kids, man. Do you want your kids to grow up without a father or have to come visit you in jail? Yeah. I mean, so something has to scare him straight. And if the love of your kids won't do it, then I don't know what will.
I don't know what will either. It's unfortunate, but it's already, I'm tired of it. If he wants to do it, fine, whatever.
But you know what's got to matter is he's got to get tired of it.
Yeah, that's the main thing. He has to want to help himself get better.
I'll talk about it briefly here. I dated a girl who was in recovery, and I'm going to guess the year of 2010. And what I learned a lot from being her and realizing, you know, why people become addicts and whatnot. And one of the things that I also learned and I got out of that is that drinking or drugs or whatever isn't right for her. Like, you know, she can never just smoke a joint or take a drink of alcohol because that would send her off the deep end, and that would be the worst thing that could happen to her, right? But because that's not for her doesn't mean that it's not for somebody else. And I don't mean like coke and heroin and that shit. I mean, a drink of alcohol isn't the end of the world for most of us. Right. So what I found in the relationship was I was living by her rules that she has to live, which aren't necessarily my rules. And I was fine not drinking. Right. But then one day something happened. And actually, I'll tell you what happened. I went to lunch or breakfast or something with one of my friends. And we were talking and she called and I didn't pick it up. She knew where I was. She knew what I was doing. And I didn't pick it up. And then she started blowing me up. And I looked down and one of the texts said, "I've never felt like using more in my life." And it was all because I didn't pick up. Yeah. So right then and there, I decided I can't be in a relationship and have that held over my head. Right. Because look, I'm like this with anybody. If you and I are recording and I get a phone call, I'm not answering the phone call.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we're having dinner and eating and talking, I'm not answering my phone. I'm not answering texts. I'll put it up and put it in my pocket. That's how I am. I give everybody the same, you know, courtesy. Right. And that she knew that's how I was. And that's what she knew where I was. I mean, what am I doing at, you know, 10, 11 o'clock in the morning on a Thursday? I'm not into any kind of trouble if that's crossed her mind. And that one little scenario that she could kind of put that on me that she felt like using, I said, that's it. And I broke it up. So, you know, Jeff might just be one of these people who they can't just have a drink. They can't, you know, they have one, they got to have 10.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's just an unfortunate thing. I mean, I know nothing about addiction of that sort. I can't, you know, I could say all I want and stuff like that, but I honestly don't know Jack about it. And but I do hope Jeff Hardy gets the help he needs before he gets hurt or he hurts somebody.
Well, you know, I did hear someone talk about they'd had a cocaine and I don't know, alcohol too, but cocaine addiction. Mm-hmm. And they got straight by smoking pot. He says a lot of people have done that. And it was a podcast that I listened to. And actually, it was Carrie Silkin's podcast. And he didn't go into great detail about getting off of the coke and the whatever, but pot, and he used pot as a way to calm him down. And I thought, you know, that's great that absolutely worked for him. And, you know, I don't think everybody has to be a teetotaler. Right.
Right.
I think that doesn't work for them. You know, for instance, when I was dating this girl, at the same time, there was some other people who were involved in church that, we went to who were in rehab. And one of the associate pastors, or one of the pastors, not the main guy, but the, one of the other guys, one day on his way home from work, stopped at a gas station, got a double deuce and drank it and took it home to his wife and set it on the counter and said, okay, it's done. It's over with, you know, like, and was just all upset and brokenhearted because he had a beer. Right. And I get that, like, you know, for some people counting the days, oh, I've got 700 days sober. I've got 7 years sober. It works. Right. But you know, some people you always have that hanging over your head. And I said, big freaking deal. It's a beer. And it's not like he had a beer and now he's doing coke or smoking crack and heroin and whatever and got hookers. He had a beer and was able enough to come and set the drink down and tell his wife, and they could work through it. But it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
It's the end of his run there of sobriety. However, it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
So I hope that whatever, I hope Jeff finds something, because if for no other reason, you know, his wife, if he still has one, needs a husband, and his daughter needs a dad.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I'm totally horrible when I'm high. just letting you know.
Oh, you mean on weed?
Weed and shrooms.
Oh yeah. I could see everybody being horrible on shrooms, but on weed, why are you horrible on weed?
Oh, because I talk really loud.
Okay.
I'm only second-handed, right? No, actually, no, I did direct. Anyway, I talk really loud, and because I, for some reason, I lose my hearing or something, or
oh wow,
or whatever, or I think nobody's hearing me, and then okay, so one time I got high. I don't get high often. I don't get high anymore, but I mean, I have friends that have smoked weed and I've gotten like secondhand high and
yeah, the old contact buzz.
Yeah. And that's enough to affect me. So we were at Blockbuster Video and I was talking really loud, being kind of obvious that I'm not, you know, that I'm, it's obvious that I'm impaired. And I kept looking at my hands because everything was choppy. So I was like, whoa, my hands, look at my hands. You know, just like, and I almost knocked over an entire shelf of videos, the video boxes, because I guess my motor function sucked too. So my friends were like, okay, you're not going with us anymore when we're smoking. So yeah, that's how I am when I'm weed high. When I'm shroom high, I laugh all the time. And I have this weird endurance that I would want to walk for hours on end. So the thing was, took shrooms with my friends. We laughed all night and we went out for a 4-hour walk around the neighborhood. Just laughing. And I would love to have that kind of endurance when I'm exercising and trying to lose weight, but it was just, I was just having a great time. I had all this energy. We were just walking for 4 hours from, 3 hours from 1 a.m. to 4 a.m. just around the neighborhood, just laughing and telling jokes and saying that we should make our own shrooms by crapping into a pot of soil and watering it every now and then. Just some stupid shit. But yeah, that's how I am with shrooms. So I don't know. This is, it's so weird. And then I'm a sleepy drunk, so I don't like getting drunk either. Because I fall asleep.
Okay. Wow.
But I don't do those stuff anymore.
So your drug of choice is food.
Yeah. it's actually caffeine. I'm always caffeinated some way. Always. Sucks. But yeah, caffeine is my drug of choice nowadays. I wish I didn't have to depend on it though. I mean, I have to take like over I for me to like fully feel good would be over 200 milligrams of caffeine. Or close to 300.
You know they have different strains of weed?
Yeah, there's a lot.
Yeah, but I've heard some of them will help you focus. Some of them will give you energy. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah. Have you heard supposedly. That? Yeah, I've heard that. I don't know if it's true or not, but yeah, probably. I mean, I don't know. I haven't dabbled in that, so. I'm sure. I got to ask my friend. He does that stuff, so.
Okay. Yeah. We're going to wrap up.
Okay.
We'll call this the ADD or the drug episode. I don't know. But anyway, I'm going to give you some advice off air.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can about drugs.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And then we could talk about that. But I do want to say, hey, you know, a lot of the Brothershippers give gifts. If you feel like giving a gift, I'm just going to throw this out there. Give a gift to the moderators, Michael Herrick, Mark Hartwick, Travis Raines. They deserve it. They make the Brothership. They help keep it safe and sound. And I'm sure Jeff and Barry do their part of moderating as well. So give those folks some gifts as well. But definitely those moderators. I'm very thankful that we have the Brothership. And I have all these friends that that are my friends and that are just through this Facebook group and this, you know, one common love of pro wrestling and the best podcast of the planet, Breaking Kayfabe with Boudry and Barry.
Yay. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, next week I'm going to try and talk to Brandon New. Mm-hmm. And okay. If there's anybody else that wants to be on the podcast, please just message me. I'd love to get you on and we could talk about whatever you want. And only need about, you know, 45 minutes, an hour of your time.
Oh, yeah.
not you, Ariel. I've already got you. But somebody else, you know.
Oh, yeah.
If anybody wants to be on, I want to have the Brothership on. If not, then I'll go to my well of guests that I have. I've got somebody that I can call and they'll talk and they're not in the Brothership, but they could tell some stories that will probably be embarrassing to me.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
All righty. Sounds good.
All right. Great. Well, I want to thank everybody for listening again. Thank everybody for being a part of the Brothership. What great folks that we have there. And thanks to the moderators and Jeff and Barry for keeping the riffraff out. We love you and we'll be talking with you next week. And you'll get another, you know, hour and a half of Arrow and I BSing and then some more of some other folks talking some other stuff. I know it's pretty vague, but who knows?
Yeah, we don't prepare for this usually.
No. And we can't prepare for the craziness of the Brothershippers. So anybody that wants to be on, let me know. I'll post this one on this coming Wednesday so that we don't distract anybody from downloading Breaking Kayfabe with Balogun and Barry, even though that I don't know how anyone would confuse these two podcasts other than the name is a little similar, but I did that on purpose because comparing Breaking Kayfabe with Balogun and Barry with Broken Kayfabe is like comparing ice cream to horse manure.
Wow. Both are good in moderation. No, I'm just kidding.
All right. Out the line, but we're gonna say bye and then I'll give you some advice.
Okay. Bye everybody.
Bye.